Welcome to Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, where we bring evidence, experience, and perspective to make sense of today's leading health challenges. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
This is Stephanie Desmon. Today, we turn our attention to the origin story of the COVID-19 pandemic with Tom Inglesby, director of the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security. 3 years on, we are still actively debating whether the pandemic was caused when the virus spilled over naturally from animals in a market, or whether it was somehow caused by a Chinese lab leak. We discuss what we know, why it matters, and what lessons we can learn for the future. Let's listen. Tom Inglesby, thanks so much for joining me.
That's great to be with you.
So we are 3 years into the COVID-19 pandemic, and we are still debating how it started. And I'm wondering if you could just remind our listeners sort of the two main theories, I guess, here, natural spillover and this lab leak theory. And I'm wondering if you could talk us through a little bit about, you know, the merits of each.
Sure. So, yeah, those are the two main concerns or possibilities that are being considered by governments around the world, by scientists. And the first one is that this pandemic emerged from nature, spilled over from some animal. And I think the basis for that concern is that about 75% of emerging infectious diseases are found to have spilled over from some animal. A virus circulating in the animal population came into humans and then started causing havoc. And so obviously a very serious concern. And we know from SARS-CoV-1 in that large outbreak that civet cats was determined to be the source animal for the spillover. So certainly a very legitimate concern. And then the second possibility is that something happened that involved human accident. Anywhere from the discovery and collection of a virus from nature after scientists collected it, or after they brought the virus into the laboratory and started working on it, it accidentally infected someone who then spread it, or it was worked on in the lab and it was changed in some way that then led to the infection of a human and it spread from there. So I think the laboratory, when people say the laboratory source of infection, they mean something in that space. They may mean different things in that space, but something human generated, not intended, an accident, certainly not deliberate. And those are the two main concerns that continue to be discussed, debated, both in the U.S., but also around the world.
I guess my question is, why are we still talking about this?
Yeah, the problem is that we have lots of missing data from the earliest days of the pandemic. We don't have good epidemiologic data. We don't have good hospital data. We didn't have access to the laboratories where people were working on coronaviruses. Some of the data has been withheld. Some has been destroyed. And that absence of data or paucity of data has really led to, you know, lots of uncertainty. And so each time a new fact emerges, there's a lot of attention placed on that fact or that, you know, piece of data, maybe a shred of data. But at this point, at least in my view, we don't have a strong conclusive case for either of those explanations. And so it remains an open question and remains something that is quite animating for people. What was the cause of this terrible pandemic event? And how can we get to the bottom of it? Can we get to the bottom of it? Can we get new information, new data, primarily from scientists from China, but perhaps in other databases in the world as well?
And we know that animals spill over, that diseases spill over from animals. We know that happens. The errors can happen in labs, right? I mean, could we just focus on sort of how to make both of these things less likely to happen?
Yes, and we should. We should do whatever we can in both cases because we know that both of them are future possibilities of sources of epidemics. And at this point, are both remain possible explanations for what happened during COVID and the pandemic. So we should do both of those things. And there are many people who have called on governments and scientists and the scientific community just to act as if both of those things were the cause, and, you know, just act as if we know and do whatever we need to do to increase laboratory safety, to diminish the chances of accidents, do whatever we can do to change animal husbandry practices, perhaps in wet markets, or consider ways that we interact with the ecosystem and proximity to animals that could bring us, could carry those viruses and spill over. So we have a series of things that we should be doing. And to some extent, some governments are doing some of those things. I think there probably also is a case that if we had more certainty or closer to conclusive evidence, that there would be more international resolve to get all those things done. But I completely agree with you, which is we should be acting as if anyway, and, you know, basically not presuming that we're going to get to the bottom of it and just start making sure we do everything we can to prevent something like this from happening again.
Yeah, because I feel as though perhaps this is distracting in some way. I mean, I know that Congress is now having hearings on the origins of COVID, and I'm curious, you know, do you feel like it's a distraction? Is it important that they pursue this?
I think that given that we don't know the answer to what happened, I think we should be open to and continue to seek information and facts about what happened. But I think some of the ways that that is being pursued is very destructive. It's personal. It has caused risks to individuals. It's certainly very distracting for organizations of government. It's distracting to many scientists who are now really targeted on social media. And I don't think that's going to help us get to the bottom of things at all. I think it's going to actually create larger political divides and slow us down. So I think, yeah, I think it is a what's happening now, the way it's being pursued in a very political fashion, is a distraction. But I don't think that should stop us from a dispassionate look for facts. It just should not be personalized. People should not be going after organizations, some kind of vendetta. And I think it's possible. I think the intelligence agencies, for example, have been trying to do that work just in that way. They have been working to develop the fact basis for both theories and to see how far they can get. They've reached different conclusions. It's now the case that their work will be declassified, I think, within 90 days since that bill was signed. So we'll see what the intelligence agencies have come up with. I think they've done a dispassionate, fact-based effort to get to the bottom of things. And so in many ways, they could be a model for what we do. I don't think just because we don't know the answer now that the intelligence agencies of the United States, for example, should shut down the inquiry and be no longer interested in getting to the bottom of things. But I think the way that they proceed should be without politics or some kind of, you know, very, very strongly held view, but basically with going into this discussion agnostically.
Mm-hmm. So when I first reached out to you to do this podcast, it was because I kept hearing in the news, lab leak, lab leak, lab leak. Like that was really just, there was a lot of that in the media. And then I learned a new term, two words, raccoon dogs. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering if you could tell me, you know, about this discovery that perhaps a raccoon dog is the source of the virus, and also what that means sort of in tipping the balance in this conversation.
Yeah. So I think one of the challenges, just before I explain what's known about it, one of the challenges here is that these developments that occur around COVID origins are often presented in a media channel that is not a scientific journal. Mm-hmm. Not calling out one in particular or another or saying that it's the wrong thing for them to do that story. But when you read a story in a popular news journal, it doesn't usually contain very much scientific evidence at all. And so what you hear is very, very high level summaries, and sometimes just, I don't want to say cherry picked, but kind of selectively presented to a particular reporter. So I think in this case, we haven't seen, I think the general, the public hasn't anyway, seen any laying out of the actual science that occurred around this new raccoon dog set of revelations. And so all we have is an account from news outlets. And what those news outlets are saying is that in some one or more of the samples that were taken from the market in Wuhan, that there was evidence of raccoon dog genetic material in the same swab as evidence of SARS-CoV-2 virus. And so what some have argued is that that is in some ways some evidence that the raccoon dog is the missing link or the animal that in some ways related to spillover. But other scientists would say, and I think this is how I would interpret it, is to say that, first of all, human genetic material has been recovered with SARS-CoV-2 in some of the same environmental swabs from this market. Other animals' genetic material has been recovered with SARS-CoV-2 from the same market. So from the stories so far, it's not so clear to me what's particularly special about this new discovery. It's important just to know that the genetic material was found, but it doesn't say that the raccoon dog was even actually infected, at least the data that's presented so far. And even if it were infected, we know that many animals were able to be infected by SARS-CoV-2. So it doesn't rule out the possibility that humans infected the raccoon dog in the market. It doesn't talk about which direction the infection goes. Maybe we'll learn more when the science is presented in a scientific paper, because it will go through peer review and there'll be they have to present a pretty strong body of evidence. But at least from what's been reported so far in the popular press, that's my take on it. I'm sure there could be other takes because, again, the information is just, only bits and pieces of it have been presented.
Mm-hmm. Is part of the reason that we may never get to the bottom of this because of sort of an unwillingness of the Chinese to share what they know?
Yeah, at this point, unfortunately, the Chinese government has not allowed a lot of information to be released, and they're not allowing Chinese scientists to publish science around this. There seems to be kind of either a ban or a moratorium or whatever you want to call it, but there's you might think that there would be a whole legion of scientific papers coming out to go after the evidence and to present various cases, and that's not happening at all. So maybe that will change. Hopefully that will change, and there'll be continued beseeching of the Chinese government to release more information about cases and timelines and epidemiologic information and the pattern of the virus in the earliest days. But at this point, there is a lot of missing data that make it hard, and the Chinese government really does have control over that data.
Mm-hmm. So what do you think happened?
I don't know. I think I am open to both possibilities, either a natural spillover or a laboratory problem that occurred somewhere along the chain.
What's the lesson here, sort of in this whole debate over the beginnings of the pandemic?
Well, I think one of the lessons is that we should anticipate that in future major epidemics or pandemics, that there will be this kind of uncertainty unless there's a whole change in the earliest days. We should have international teams working on origin questions from the earliest days of future events. It may be that countries will try to block that, but it may be that some countries would welcome that, and we should be prepared to go in with all of the right scientific capabilities to try and get to the bottom of things as quickly as possible, because the longer time passes, the colder the scientific record, the forensic record, the data. So, but we should anticipate that this would be the case in the future, and do whatever we can to commit to sharing data and to having international expertise brought to bear at the earliest days of a pandemic.
Tom Inglesby, thanks so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate you talking about it.
Public Health On Call is a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmon. Audio production by J.B. Arbogast, Holly Cardinale, Philip Porter, Spencer Greer, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media run by Grace Fernandez and Shian Briscoe. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Thank you for listening.